Everybody. Boy, I tell you, this is a good-looking crowd, amen? I tell you, y'all hear me okay? I'll try to talk louder in a little bit, okay? That work? All right. Well, it's good to see you. Hey, Miss Jimmy.
Love you.
It's good to see everybody this morning. I hope everybody has had a good morning so far and come ready to worship the Lord. You know, that's why we gather, just to corporately worship Him and to learn about Him. And I'm thankful that we're able to gather together this way. I'm going to tell you what, it's good to see you this morning. Brother, would you slip right into this microphone right here? Listen, and pray for us, please. Open us up in a word of prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, to thank you for allowing us to be here this morning.
Yes, God.
We pray that as the word is spoke this morning, that we'll deal with it in our hearts, in our minds. Lord, we pray that this coronavirus will go away.
Yes.
That you'll bless this nation. Lord, this nation needs you so
yes,
bad.
Yes, God, we do.
And our president, Lord, our president needs your prayers. He is trying his best, but Lord, he needs your strength.
Yes, God. God.
Thank you again for allowing us to be here. I look forward to the word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank y'all so much for being here. I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Renee and them. Mm-hmm. I'm going to sit right behind
you. Hi, good morning, everybody. It's good to see everybody. I've missed you guys. See some new faces. Hallelujah. This morning we're going to do two songs for you. The first one we're going to do is, they're both a little bit different arrangements than what the hymnal is, but the first one's Praise Him, Praise Him. And we talked about it at the 9 o'clock hour. You know, sometimes it is a little difficult to praise the Lord in certain situations. And you're welcome. Sorry about that, technical difficulties. You know, it's especially, I think we would all agree that we have faced challenges the last several months, you know, with the situation that we're all in. But we need to try to remember to keep our faith, keep your faith strong. And I want to encourage you too, kind of my mantra for this week is, when you look at problems, you see more problems, right? Can I get an amen?
Amen?
Amen. But when you look at possibilities, you will see more possibilities. So try to remember that as you go in and out your day-to-day. Look and see how maybe God can use a situation you might be in. But above all, remember to praise Him. He's got this under control, okay? I know sometimes you're probably kind of scratching your head wondering. Some of us type A personalities have a problem with control, of not being able to run the show and not know what's going on, when it's going on, how it's going to go on, and all that. Okay, well, okay, you too. Got the peanut pack over here. But you know, just have faith. God's got this. Okay, so it's gonna be all right, guys. Whatever it is, it's gonna be all right. Just remember to praise Him. If you know these words, feel free to join in with us. Go ahead, brother.
Strength and honor.
goodness. Praise Him, praise Him, ever in joyful song. The crucified, sound His praises, Jesus who bore our sorrows, love unbounded, wonderful, deep and strong. Praise Him, praise Him, tell of His excellent greatness. Praise Him,
for those technical difficulties. I couldn't hear anything. Could you?
Can you give me a hot spot?
Hang on just a minute, Chuck.
Can you? No.
Y'all gotta love it. We can't sing if we can't hear.
Well, I ain't got one, baby.
Can you pull the one in here from the hall?
No, it won't reach.
I'll turn it up.
Chuck, gonna turn it up.
Okay, turn it up. All right, turn it up. Yeah, yeah.
We can still praise Him through all the turmoil.
Oh, Chuck gonna make us sing whether we're ready or not.
Hey,
okay.
Go, Chuck.
Okay. This is Blessed Be the Name.
Blessed be the name of the Lord, the glories of my God and King. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Y'all sing it, y'all know it.
Blessed be the name, blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Jesus, the name that charms our fears. Blessed be the name of the Lord. His music in the sinner's ears. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord.
It says, I never shall forget that day.
Yep.
I never shall forget that day. Blessed be the name of
when
the
Jesus
Lord.
When Jesus washed my sins away.
When Jesus washed my sins away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Again.
Blessed be the name, blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord.
Aren't we blessed?
Amen.
Aren't we blessed? Amen.
I believe that's the best thing I've heard since March. Amen? I tell you right now, that done my heart good. I don't know about you. Praise God, that was good. Hey, if you got your Bibles, if you will, turn with me this morning to Luke chapter number 24. I just want to share with you. I was thinking about it this morning, and I never really thought about it, but if it was a chapter in the Bible that I liked, I hesitate to say my favorite, because usually my favorite is the one that I'm studying at that time. But if I were to say there's a favorite one in there, if I had to categorize one, Luke chapter 24 would probably encompass my favorite scriptures. Okay, so Luke chapter number 24. Actually, we're going to start looking in verse number 30. The first part of that you've heard every Easter, probably since you have been saved, or even before you were saved when you started coming to church. It gives the account of very early in the morning on the first day of the week, they came down to the sepulcher and they found it. What condition was it in when they found it? Empty. Absolutely. It was empty. Okay. That's what takes place. It's empty. They go out to see it. And when they got there, the stone was rolled away. We all know the story. Jesus wasn't in there. Mary saw somebody in the garden. If you read all four accounts of it, somebody saw somebody who she thought was the gardener, who was actually Christ. And then she goes back and she tells them there, she says, hey, he's alive. And he goes back to Jerusalem and tells them, okay? And that's going to pick us up. Actually, I said was going to start in verse 30, but let's start in verse 13. Luke chapter 24, verse number 13. And behold, two of them went that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 70 furlongs. That's about 7 miles if you was measuring it, okay? And they talked together of all the things which had happened. And it came to pass that while they communed together and reasoned, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were holden that they should not know him. And he said unto them, what manner of communications are these that ye have one with another as ye walk and are sad? And the one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answering, said unto him, art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem, and hast not known the things which are come to pass there in those days, in these days? And he said unto them, what things? And they said unto him concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and have crucified him. But we trusted that it had been. Now, see, I want you to listen to this. They start going and talking about themselves. Listen to this. But we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel. And beside all this, today's the third day by the way, just where you'll know, the Jews felt like it, the spirit hovered around the grave for 3 days, so they waited 3 days to make sure that a person was dead a lot of times. He wasn't really dead till you'd been dead 3 days, okay? So he goes on and it says, because I thought you might come back. I wonder how many people was buried alive back in. I mean, I got them thoughts coming. I'm like Mark Larry. Them crazy thoughts hit my brain every once in a while. But go ahead and let's see. And it says this. It says, the third day since these things were done, yea, and certain women also of our company made us astonished, which were early at the sepulcher, and when they found not his body, they came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels, which said that he was alive. And certain of them which were with us went to the sepulcher and found it even so as the women had said, but him they saw not. Then he said unto them, O fools, and slow of heart, to believe all of the prophets have spoken. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them on all the scriptures the things concerning himself. And they drew nigh unto the village whither they went, and he made as though he would have gone further, but they constrained him, saying, Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to tarry with them. And it came to pass, as he sat at meat with them, he took bread and blessed it and brake it and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight. Brother Scott, care us the Lord, please. Yes, God. Amen. You know, if I were to, if it's been said, this is title of my message. My title of my message today is A Picture's Worth a Thousand Words. A Picture's Worth a Thousand Words. You know, it's been said that a picture's worth a thousand words, and the fact that you can describe something in vivid detail, and all people have is what their imagination can conjure up. You can describe it in vivid detail, and people will still have a hard time grasping what you're talking about. You see, I might describe my grandboys. I might tell you that my oldest grandboy is he's sort of stocky built. He's starting to get muscles everywhere, and he's a good looking, he's a handsome young man, black headed, favors Ricky Duke, but I can't help that. I wish Ricky had been here for that. Maybe he's watching. Amen. But anyway, he's just a good looking young man, and I could go on and describe him, and I could describe my youngest grandson. I could tell you that, boy, he's about that tall. He's thin as a pole bean, and he's red headed, and looks a lot like me. But you know, you might get up some kind of idea of what he looked like, but you still have a hard time wrapping him in. Matter of fact, I could probably describe to you one of my suits. I could tell you that I got a green suit. It's probably, I tell you that it's got a little red in it, and might tell you it had a little white in it. But I got a green suit, and I might even tell you that, you know what, it might have old Santa Claus hat on it or something. But you might not get the same picture from me describing it as a suit that I wore here last Christmas, if you happen to remember. Do y'all remember my suit? Ain't no way I can describe that as good as what you can get when I show it to you in a picture, are there? There's just absolutely no way. Well, this morning, as I said, I want to share with you a message on a picture is worth a thousand words. You see, if you'll join me this morning in Luke chapter 24, Jesus has not long been crucified, just 3 days ago. 3 days ago they had crucified him, and 3 days ago they had taken him and they had placed him in Joseph's tomb. Do you remember that? They had taken him and had placed him there, and this morning, 3 days later, they had went this very morning and they had went to the sepulcher and the ladies had found it empty. Mary said that she had seen him. But boy, that's hard to believe. And then when she came back to talk to the rest of them, talk to us here there in Jerusalem, she told everyone. And Peter and John, they jumped up and they ran to the tomb. And when they ran to the tomb, they returned and they said it was just like what Mary had said. Jesus' disciples had believed in him. They had thought that he would redeem Israel. They had thought that he would come and he would break the bondage of Israel, the bondage that they were held captive by Rome. You see, they believed that he was a mighty prophet of God that was come, and yet he was dead. They felt like he was going to redeem them. They felt like he had been sent by God. He was God's man. And yet here they are 3 days after his death. And now his body's vanished. They don't know what's happened. They'd seen him taken from the Garden of Gethsemane. They had watched from a distance as they had crucified him. They had, and they knew the trials and the reasons that they had put him to death was not right. They knew that even Pilate had done everything that he could to get around doing it. But nevertheless, they knew that he was dead. They had seen him placed in the sepulcher, and they had knew that he was wrapped, lying in Joseph's tomb. And 3 days later, they hear the people talking about that had been to the tomb. They had heard something about a vision. Let me ask you this. With everything that they had heard and everything that they had been said to them, what kind of frame of mind had you been there in Jerusalem that morning as a disciple of Christ? What kind of frame of mind do you think you'd be in? I believe I would be like the two that was on the road to Emmaus. I feel like that my mind would be filled with bewilderment. What in God's name is going on? You were just bewildered by the whole thing. Jesus had told them a bunch of stuff. He had taught them a lot of stuff. But boy, it just didn't work out like what I thought. And they were bewildered by it. You see, if we were to back up and you will look in verse number 14 of Luke chapter 24, look at it and stay with me. Verse 13 and stay with me if you will. And behold, two of them went that same day to a village called Emmaus. See, they had all they could take. They was leaving. They was out of there. You know what? Did you know that when I done this study, do you know how now you're going to find as we read this, it was Cleopas. But do you know who most of the scholars believe the other disciple was? It was Cleopas' wife. He took his wife and said, "Hey, I've had enough of this. We've trusted in him. We believe in him. And boy, all of our hopes has been dashed. I'm telling you right now, have you ever just wanted to run away? I mean, you, buddy, you've had it and you're ready to go." Well, that's pretty much the way they was on the road to Emmaus. They was ready to leave. They was ready to get out of there. I want you to stay with me now, and I want you to see this, which was from Jerusalem about 70 furlongs, which was, like I told you earlier, it was about 7 miles. They said, "We're going to escape this craziness." And as they walked, they were talking over what happened. Possibly they was talking about his arrest. Maybe they were talking about Gethsemane. I don't know. Maybe they were talking about how that Judas, can you believe that Judas was betrayed Jesus? Can you believe that he turned his back on him after all that he saw? Or maybe possibly they were talking about the fact that Pilate could have stopped it. All he had to done was said no. Why'd he let the high priest and the voice of the people sway him so much? All he had to done was said no. He said himself he didn't find any fault in him. Why did he do this? Can you imagine their conversation? What about this? Maybe they were just rolling it over and over and over in their mind. Maybe they were thinking about the fact that Mary and him said they had saw a vision. They'd seen angels. Who sees angels, you know? They'd seen angels at the tomb, and they'd told them that why seek you the living among the dead? Well, there were no ifs, ands, and buts for them. Because like is in life, there's no ifs. Aren't we good about playing the if game? Well, we get on the backside of something, we say, well, if this person had done that, or if this done this, or if this done that, but the truth of the matter, if never happens. And these two were broken. They were sad, the Scripture says. The Scripture says, and as they walk, Jesus comes close, and then as he comes close, he perceives their sadness. And in verse number 16, listen to what it says. When he drew nigh to him, look what it says. It says, and their eyes were holden that they should not know him. I want to stop, and I want to give you something right here. This won't cost you a nickel, okay? But let me tell you something. Sometimes when you are bewildered by the events that has taken place in your life, no matter what they might be, it gets hard to see the Lord at work in whatever you got going on. It's hard to see him. It's hard to fathom that God's in the midst of everything that's going on. But I got news for you. This won't cost you nothing either. He always is. He's never left you, no, not once, is the promise that we get from his holy word. Never one time has he left you. Listen to this. As we go on and look at this right here, I want you to see this. The Bible says that their eyes were holding. That means they were restrained. They wasn't able to. And in verse 18, Cleopas just can't believe it. Look at here. I want to show you that. And I want you to notice it. That they kind of want to rebuke Jesus. Can you imagine rebuking Jesus just a little bit? Can you imagine getting on to him? Look here, Jesus done drawed up close to him, and look what he said. And one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered and said unto him, Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem and don't know what happened? How in the world can you have been in Jerusalem? You following us down this road. You come from Jerusalem just like we did. How in God's name did you not know what's happened? And he said unto them, I like this. What things? What things happened? You see, the bottom line is they were asking him, says, don't you know what happened? Don't you know he was falsely arrested? Don't you know that he had a mock trial? Don't you know that he had that he was crucified when they could find no fault in him? Don't you know those things took place? That's what they were saying to him. But then Jesus said, he says, what things? Don't you understand what really happened? There's a lot of difference in the physical things that happened and the spiritual things that happened. You see, the physical things that happened, yes, it was awful. Jesus was arrested, falsely arrested, falsely tried, hung on a cross, buried in a tomb. All that was bad. I mean, that's the physical. But what about the spiritual side of it? Look what he says in verse number 26. Jesus himself said this to him. He tells them first, verse 25, he tells them first, he said, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Ought, you see the word ought, that ought. My wife told me one time, said, you ought not to say ought. Why don't you know the Bible says it, I can say it too. Amen. Ought. You know what that means? That means divinely to be so. Let me put it another way. To be so divinely. Did you get that? Divinely. Ought. Should not. Divinely. Should not Christ have suffered these things and entered into his glory? Where are you going with this, Brother Mark? You hang on. I'm fixing to get there. I'm fixing to be done my introduction in a minute. Y'all just hang on. I got you today. Praise God. Listen to me. Robert, you guard the door, okay? Listen to this. Here's what it says. He says the word ought, it means needful to fulfill the prophecies. These are that Jesus had to do this to fulfill the prophecies. And he reminds them that it was a divine necessity that these things happen. He relates to them the scriptures concerning his death, his burial, and his resurrection. Listen to it. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets. You think I keep you a long time? He began with Moses and all the prophets, expounding unto them. What is that? In all the scriptures, the things concerning himself. You're talking about getting your clock cleaned. He done come and he done told them everything from the beginning up until now. The whole purpose of his coming, he's done told them all the scriptures of prophecy. And I got news for you. They are not unlike you and I. Hindsight for them was 2022. I'm going to show you that in a minute. You just hang on. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them all the scriptures, the things concerning himself. And they drew nigh unto the village whither they went, and he made as though he would have gone further. But they constrained him, saying, Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to tarry with them. I want you to notice something. They still don't recognize him. They still hadn't got a clue that it's Jesus. They still hadn't got a clue. Even after he tells them everything that happened, he still doesn't reveal. He's still not, their eyes are still restrained. You know why? Because they're still stuck on the poor, pitiful me. Y'all awake this morning? I want you to hold that thought. Okay? Here's what. They drew nigh. They constrained him. Abide with us, for it is toward evening. The day is far spent. And he went in to tarry with them. Verse 30. Won't you hang on to verse 30? I ain't going to even elaborate on it, but I want you just to hang on to it. I'm going to read it. You hang on to it. Can you hang on to it, Farmer? Say amen. Amen. Listen to verse 30. And it came to pass, as he sat at meat with them, he took bread and blessed it and brake it and gave it to them, and their eyes were opened and they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight. Don't you hang on to that. You got it? You got it? Say amen. I want to make sure you got it. I'm going to hurry up. Listen to this. As we read through this, I want you to hold that. Listen to this. Now fast forward, if you will, with me down to verse 33. In verse 33, their eyes has been opened. They rose up the same hour, returned to Jerusalem. Wait a minute, it was dark. They was turning into the Emmaus. They was going to spend the night there. It was getting too late to travel. But that didn't constrain them when their eyes had been opened, when they understood who he is and the importance of everything that had happened. Hey, we got to get back to Jerusalem. So they take off and they head back to Jerusalem. Listen to this. In verse 34, they get to Jerusalem. And here, when he gets to Jerusalem, the people at Jerusalem, verse 34, said, The Lord is risen indeed and hath appeared unto Simon. That's the first thing. Can you imagine with all that they knew, their eyes had been opened, they realized it was Jesus, and they had just heard a blistering message about the whole purpose of him coming. They understood, they had enlightenment, and they run up in the crowd, they ready to tell everybody, and when they walk in, the crowd hits them. Well, guess what? Hey, Peter, Simon, he's seen Jesus. They said, well, let me tell you what happened to us. Can you imagine that? Let me tell you what. And they told what things were done in the way and how he was known of them in the breaking of bread. Hang on to that again. Y'all think I'm going to preach on bread in a minute, don't you? I ain't got nothing to say about bread. You just hang on. And as they spake, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and saith unto them, Peace be unto you. I like how Jesus showed up. He said, oh, yeah, you're going to need some peace for this. Amen. In the midst of them, Jesus shows up. And if you read the rest of that scripture right there, what you're going to find is you're going to find in the very next verse, what does he do when he speaks? Every one of them, it says in verse 37, But they were terrified and affrighted. Terrified. What happens when you're terrified? Well, let me tell you something. I was sitting in the cab of a truck one time, and y'all have heard me tell this story before, but OCW I worked in partners with was hid in the sleeper of the truck. Y'all remember me telling that story, some of you? And he was hid in the sleeper of the truck. I got in the truck, and when I got in the truck, I raised the curtain to look for CW. CW wasn't in there, and I let it back down, and I looked around, I raised up, looked over the out the front of the truck, and I looked in the mirrors. I couldn't find him, and I raised that curtain up again, and I looked for him. I couldn't find him. He wasn't nowhere in the truck, And all of a sudden, when I let that back down, CW, he reaches out and grabs me by the chest. That's just around from behind my seat. Says, rawr, and grabs me. And when he does, I was terrified because I left the truck. I left it. I got out. I was scared. Hair standing up on the back. The trouble of it is my feet didn't come with me. That's another story for another day, but I was terrified. See, terrified means that you're so scared that you run away. That's why he spoke, he told him, said, peace be still. But why are you troubled? Why do your thoughts arise in your heart? Listen to this, verse 39. This is it. I'm done with my introduction when I read 39. Y'all ready? He says, behold, my hands and my feet. Behold. My hands and my feet. You know what he was doing? He was trying to confirm to him, to everybody there, just who he was. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. If I was going to confirm to you who I was, I'd show you a picture. Now, I might show you a better picture than that. I might take distractions away. And if I was going to confirm to you that I was a pastor at Central Hatchie, I might show you just my face. But Jesus doesn't show them his face, does he? Instead, he shows them his hands and his feet. Now, I want you to think about this just for a minute. Can I have a few more minutes, or are y'all ready to go? Listen. First of all, I want you to see right here, he says, behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. First thing is, they had all walked the journey with him. You see, they should have recognized his hands and feet immediately. Because you know what? They should have recognized it because they walked that dusty road and they followed him. They should have recognized it because they had saw those feet as they walked on the water when he came to them during the storm. They should have recognized his hand because it was the same hand that when Peter said, Lord, if it's you, bid me to come to you. And Peter steps out of the boat and looks at the wind and the waves. It was that hand when Peter cried, save me, that reached out and took him by the hand and immediately brought him to safety. They should have recognized his hands, friend, because it was with those hands that he reached down when the woman who was caught in adultery was brought before him. It was his hand that was riding on the ground. They should have recognized his hands because his hands was the same hands that had reached out and lifted the little girl off of her deathbed. It was the same hands, my friend, that he had taken his fingers and he'd stuck them in the ears of a deaf man. And it was the same hand that touched the same man, the deaf and the dumb, and he touched his tongue after he'd spit. And friends, I want you to don't know, I didn't study on the spit. I studied on the hand. Listen to me. It was that same hand, and they ought to recognize it, that touched that tongue. And that man that was deaf and dumb went away here and speaking, friends. They ought to recognize those hands. It was those same hands, my friend, that created the world, my friend, that is gentle enough to touch the eye of a blind man. They ought to recognize his hands, my friend. You know why? Because if you go back and you look, everything that God ever created, he created from the beginning. If you go back and read, and on the sixth day, everything he had created, he had spoke into existence right up to the time when he created man. And it was out of the dust of the earth that God himself put a personal touch on it and fashioned and formed man with his own hand, friend. Listen to this. He didn't speak man to existence. He created him. Let me share this with you. You stay with me. Not only that, but he also, because man was his pet prize, if you will. That's a good word. God himself planted a vineyard called the Garden of Eden. God himself placed man into it. I tell you these things because it's important for you to know God's hand had always been toward man. You don't believe me? Let me share this with you. Y'all stay with me. I want to tell you something now. Let me remind you. Do you remember Moses? Moses, the one that God chose to lead his children. You remember that? Out of bondage. You remember what he done? He hid him in a cleft of rock one time. Do you remember that? What is a cleft of a rock? It's nothing but a big old crack. Oh, Moses got in a crack. God took his hand and he told him, says, you can't look upon me, but I'm going to put my hand over you. And while I pass by, and when I pass by, I'm going to remove my hand and you'll be able to see my backside. You remember that? And that's exactly what he did. You say, well, how big is God's hand? That man, you remember what he said? Jesus said, of those that my Father gives me, I've lost none of them. They're in my hand. You remember that? He's lost none of them. How big is God's hand? Let me tell you how big God's hand is. If you look in the book of Isaiah, you'll find that God's hand was so big that when he measured the ocean, they said it was just the span of his hand. God's hand's big, and those disciples ought to recognize his hand. They might not be able to recognize his face, but blessed be to God, you can recognize his hand and his feet. Jesus, if we go back over here and look, man, I could preach on that all day. I'm going to hush now. I know y'all getting ready to go home. Go ahead and say it. Listen to what he said. He said, behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Listen to this. Handle me. Handle me and see, for the Spirit hath not flesh and bones as you see me have. Listen at verse 40. And when he had thus spoken, he showed them his hands and his feet. If you go back and you look, the original word for showed, it means he put on display. He displayed to them those hands and those feet. And by the way, those hands and those feet bore the scars that had been placed upon him 3 days earlier for my sin and for your sin and for every one of those disciples' sin. And he'd revealed it beginning at Moses, and he had revealed it to those there. I'm going to show you this, and this I'm going to close. Y'all ready for me to close? And I know y'all are. Listen to this. If you follow on down, he tells them, he said, I want something to eat. They give him a piece of boiled fish and honeycomb. And as he took it and did eat before them, he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which was written in the law of Moses and the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me. I told you this was going to happen. They was confused. They had problems. And then listen. Then opened he their understanding that they might understand the Scriptures. And he said unto them, thus it is written, thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And ye are witnesses of these things. And behold, I send the promise of the Father upon ye, that but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. Boy, he tells them. got a job to do. In verse 50, he leads them out as far as to Bethany. Don't you catch this? And he blessed them. What was their blessing? Well, I just kind of skipped that. Listen to what he says. And he lifted up his hands and blessed them. He lifted up his hands. Those same hands that had done all that stuff. He lifts up. And while he blessed them, he was parted from them and carried into heaven. And they worshiped him. Their whining was transformed into worship when they saw his hands. There was two on the road to Emmaus. And you remember I told you to hang on to a thought a while ago? That I told you that he had preached those scriptures concerning, from starting at Moses, concerning himself. You know why I believe their eyes were finally opened? It was because when he broke that bread and he gave it to them, they saw his hands. Amen. They saw the scars where he bore the sin. Belong to them. Oh, I want to see him. Y'all remember that? Hot dog, ain't that good? Woo! Give me one, Bailey. Woo! That's right. That's good right there. So you this morning, here's my closer. There's a lot of things in life that causes us to be bewildered, muddles our minds, causes us to question and to doubt. Does God even care? Has God lost control? Or whatever else you can think of to say right now. But the truth of the matter is, when we feel that way, look at his hands and look at his feet. Look what he's provided. Because he is a wonderful, amazing, awesome Savior. Maybe this morning you don't know him. You know about him, but you don't know him. You've heard the scriptures, but you can't see him. Then today's a good day to look at his hands and his feet. Because he did it all for humanity. You've been special to him, and his hand has been towards you from day one. And he has not removed his hand from you. Somebody asked me the other day, Brother Mark, do you think God's took his hand off of us? I sure don't. If it wasn't for God's hand, oh, what a mess we'd be in. We need to worship him like we believe that. We need to praise him like we believe these scriptures. We need to honor what he did for us, that he could be able to bring glory to himself through our worship. He loves us. Maybe today, right where you are, as I said, you don't know him. Maybe You're like some of these disciples. Everything that's happened, you're just bewildered. Why don't you let him bring some clarity to your life situation? Why don't you just put all your faith and trust in him and surrender totally to him? Maybe you want to, this morning, rededicate your life, or maybe you need to be saved. We're going to have a song of invitation in a minute. And the Holy Spirit's working. But you got to let him. So why don't you respond to him as he pricks your heart? The front's all open. Maybe you just want to come and stand. You want to kneel. You want to come sit in the front seat, or come up here and sit in the seat, whatever. Whatever the Lord tells you to do. Or at home, maybe you just want to bow your head and pray and ask him to come into your life. As a song of invitation is given, you just respond according to the Holy Spirit. Stand your feet all over the house. Can you see his hands? Have you got a clear vision of his feet? His feet has brought the gospel, the truth to you. His hands are willing to perform a work in you. Will you let him? Spirit's working in your heart. Don't deny him. Maybe you just want to come and pray for somebody. Come on. Whatever you need to do, be obedient today. Look at his hands. His feet. Would you come? Would you come? Amen. I can make it. Amen. Good in his hand. You hear that? In his hand. Woo! Come on this morning. God's been knocking on your heart's door, and you've been putting it off. Today's the day. Today's the day when he's drawing you back to himself. Won't you come? Be restored. Go from whining to worship this morning. Name Jesus. Come on, can you do it? Oh, I know that I can make it. I know. Ain't you glad his ain't in mine? Boy, I tell you, I make a mess out of it, but he never does. Amen? Woo! God's good.
No matter what may
Father God, I am indeed glad that my life is in your hands. I'm thankful today, God, to know you as Savior and Lord. God, as I think about that word Lord, that means you have got supreme rule in my life. I have given you authority in my life. Thank you for that, God. Now, I pray that you'd be with us as we go our separate ways. God, I pray that you'd just continue to stir our hearts. Be with those that watched us today by internet. God, I pray that you just touch them as we live streamed into those homes. Thank you for the privilege of letting the gospel come into those homes. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. Thank y'all for being here today. Anybody, anything? Well, let me make a couple announcements. First off, if you want to give your tithe, of course, I always tell everybody you put it in the church, or you can still go online, go to our website, click on there. You can give electronically, or you can snail mail it, send it to 35 Lofton Lane, Brother Ely Lofton. Either way you do that. Also, I want you to know I got some things I'm trying to get started and get planned. I wanted to ask how many of you would be interested if we were to have a Saturday night drive-in movie night? We all get together and watch one of our Christian movies out here. How would y'all like that? Would y'all like that? Show of the hands. Anybody like that? Praise God. But well, how many would not be afraid to eat a freezer of ice cream that night? Praise God. Well, all right then. Well, what we're going to do is we'll get us a movie night planned. There's one of the latest Christian movies that's out. I'm going to try to get it, and we'll show it that night, and we'll fellowship out in the wild blue yonder, and also watch that movie, if you will. They claim it as some kind of good movie, and I'd tell you the title of it, but it just don't click in my mind right now. I talked all about it yesterday, but I can't think of the name of it. But anyway, we're going to get that together and get that planned. And I love you. I hope you have a great, great day. And I'm going to ask Brother Scott to dismiss us.